Let your Holy Spirit come and take control.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark.
Glory to you, O Lord.
John said to Jesus, Master, we saw a man who is not one of us casting out devils in your name. And because he was not one of us, we tried to stop him. But Jesus said, you must not stop him. The one who works a miracle in my name is likely to speak evil of me. Anyone who is not against us is for us. If anyone gives you a cup of water to drink, just because you belong to Christ, then I tell you solemnly, he will most certainly not lose his reward. But anyone who is an obstacle to bring down one of these little ones who are faith would be better thrown into the sea with a great millstone round his neck. And if your hand should cause you to sin, cut it off. It is better for you to enter into life crippled than to have two hands and go to heaven. Into the fire that cannot be put out. And if your foot should cause you to sin, cut it off. It is better for you to enter into life lame than to have two feet and be thrown into hell. And if your eye should cause you to sin, tear it out. Better for you to enter into the kingdom of God with one eye and to have two eyes and be thrown into hell, where the one does not die nor the fire go out. The Gospel of the Lord.
Beloved in Christ, Moses asks the question, are you jealous on my account? The reality of the first reading, Eliphaz and Medad, who were not even in the tent of meeting, received the same spirit and prophesied in the name of the Lord, and the people are jealous. Very often in life, the Beatitude calls us and tells us, blessed are the poor in spirit. But when jealousy is a part of our being, we become arrogant. I don't believe that James is addressing the material wealth of people. I believe James is saying to us, sometimes when we have material possessions, we too become arrogant. we become self-centered. And so it is an attitude issue that James addresses to us. Our attitude towards life, our attitude towards our brothers and sisters. And as Christians, can we afford in this day and age, my brothers and sisters, to be self-centered? I started earlier on sharing with you some of the values of my dad, which I reflected upon at his funeral. 89 years of age, he was a young man in the RAF in World War II. He knew what it is to line up for Russia. Out of that experience, there were few things he taught his children. The one of greater value is that you never refuse anyone who asks for something to eat, because it is a very humiliating act to bring yourself to begging for food. The other quality is one that I personally have not lived, and that is, in those days he became so fed up of bread fruit, because that was the ration food in those days, that he said to his wife, "You ain't cooking that in my house." So black-eyed peas and rice, which he deemed as fly and rice, and breadfruit, we were not fortunate to eat as children, but I love them both. But the value of giving self was little. He will never sit or come home and see food in the pot and just eat without first asking, "Is there any other to eat?" And if there was somebody else that he think it was enough for two, he'd dish it out, wash the dish, and eat cheese and crackers. He thought about his children and others before any about himself. And James challenges us, my brothers and sisters, to think about other people before self. But when we are caught up in jealousy and self-centeredness, just like the beloved disciple John, we see others doing good and we try to stop them. We try to become an obstacle in their path. But you know, if we see somebody doing wrong, we go along with it. We say nothing. How amazing life is. It says to us, what are our values in life? What have we learned and what are we teaching our people? I was at my aunt's religious profession anniversary mass, 60 years as a Clooney sister, herself and five others. And the homilist reminded us of the anthropology of 60 years ago, the ending of World War II, and there in that catastrophe of life, you find young girls giving themselves as brides to the church. Some of them were celebrating 50 years. The post-Vatican period, when the church was faced with many challenges of the new spirit. And these young girls, amid those times, gave themselves to God. Today I ask myself, as I listen to the Holy Father and his pontificate Pope Francis, as he calls his people to smell the sheep, as he calls us to be inclusive and to open ourselves and to think of others, I ask myself, who will take up the call? Which one of us here, my brothers and sisters, the young, the not so young, the aged, which one of us are willing to take up the call of our Holy Father to think about others? We look at the situations of the migrants in Europe. We look at the devastation of our brothers and sisters in Dominica. We look at the crime situations in Trinidad and Tobago. And we can blame everybody down the line. What are we doing to become solutions to the problems? And Jesus said to us, and I believe if we took God's word seriously, all of us will be crippled and speechless. Because if we tear that red flag out of our mouths, that love to gossip and bad talk to people and say all manner of things, we can't talk. If we were to cut off our arms and our legs and pluck out our eyes, my brothers and sisters, where are we? But mercy says no. I am not going to let you go. The blood of the Lamb has said to us, you are precious in my eyes. And it is in that mercy we are called to go into the world, my brothers and sisters, and do the same. Now that hard? You think so? You think that is hard? It's not hard enough. It just means living different lives. It just means, my brothers and sisters, that we have to change our diets. In some cases, we may have to eat less. You know, I often tell people during Lent, it's amazing how we say we're fasting from meat, but we're eating lobster and shrimp, which is 3 times and 4 times and 5 times the price of chicken and meat food. So where is the fast? We have transformed our fast into feasting under the pretext of Lent. The first time I ate salmon filled with crab meat was at our Archbishop house in Lent. I was shocked. Friday evening I say we are under the lights of our crab meat in lobster, in salmon, pink salmon. I can't afford that in Lancashire, so I think you're gonna buy it. But I'm saying to us, we need to change our life, we need to change our perspective in life so that we can experience God's love in our midst. Until we are ready for that, my brothers and sisters, all of this is normal. All our healing masses and services are not, because we'll attend mass after mass after mass, and you know what? We're going nowhere because we have not changed who we are.
Yeah.
When we change who we are and our perspective, our outlook on life, we will experience God's grace and mercy and healing. That's a challenge for all of us. For all of us. Because it's easy for us, as Paul reminds us, we lie to the Spirit. We mock the devil. We go along with the masses. It's okay, we sell ourselves. Well, the priest doing it, so who is me? If the priest can play mass, who is me? Kind of thing, you know, that mentality. Well, look, sister doing it, so who is me? That is how we have always lived, so what happened? Ask any young boy who is trying to live a chaste and celebrate life. Ask any young girl, how much pressure they get from their peers. You need to have a man yet, you're stripping a lot. As negative and as crude as it may sound, when I was in secondary school, I was told, young children close your ears, eh? I was told to my face, what happened? You have a right to a teeth, you can't. And I ain't a spring chicken. I'm going on then. I am hearing 7-year-old boys and girls talking about what's taking place behind the primary school. Who going behind who in this day and age? 7 years, first communion candidates. And say to each other, Father, come in, don't let me talk about the G-word. We have to change our minds. We have to change our perspective, my brothers and sisters. We have to live for Christ and not for the world. Too many of us are going with the flow. It's okay because X, Y, and Z do it. It ain't okay. We are challenged today to look up, to cut off hand, foot, pluck out hand, cut top off, and live for Christ. Because we might find ourselves in the fire that does not go out. And I am afraid that I might find some of your number. I'm afraid. Because we never know. We never know if we are doing what is right. The mercy of God is available. But the mercy of God and the grace of God will only be received if we turn away from our evil ways. If we confess our sins. That's the reality.
That's the reality. And so, my brothers and sisters, let us, each one of us, become more loving, more caring. Let us, my brothers and sisters, look beyond the challenges of our own life and see where we could help the other. Because when you think in your own backyard there is disaster, the neighborhood is worse off. In your trials, in your tribulation, you can still help somebody.
Hallelujah.
God give us the opportunity to experience things so we can become agents of healing. One of our radio programs, Sky Radio 99.5 FM, had a discussion the other day on the statement, I know what you're going through. And we invited people to call in to share that statement that we so often share with people. Could we really know what somebody is going through if we don't smell the sheep? In every case of loss, the grief process is different. You have this psychological outline, the denial, the acceptance, the withdrawals, but the process is different. How do you say to a mother who left her child sleeping, a friend called the child in the middle of the night to go out and kill the child in a car accident, and you living and my child gone, and know what you're going through? You could never know. But you could be present as a source of inspiration and grace. You know, we find time, I often say, for 9 nights, awake, fat as it has turned out to be. But when the person is sicker, we have one day every time to go and visit them in. We have no time to go and pray with them. You know how many people call me from parish and say, Father, no longer waiting for somebody to bring communion for a sick husband? And they haven't yet? You know how long I'm waiting for this? You know how long? How many people have laid the
church says to us, when I was sick as the Adventist and the Pentecostal and Jehovah Witness came to my home and prayed with me. Catholic brothers and sisters, where are we? Where is the mercy of God? And then we get vexed and jealous like John when people go to the other denomination because we did not do our responsibility. We can't get vexed. What we need to do is do what we have to do. And that's a challenge that we are called to today. That's a challenge, my brothers and sisters, that even if it's a glass of water, we share with another person because we believe and we love God, your reward will not go unnoticed. A glass of water. As simple as that, Jesus put it in. A glass of water. But I also ask myself, before water, what I don't know what we used to do in church, you know. Because everybody drinking water during mass now. And dressed like cell phone. Before cell phone, I don't know how we lived and existed. In most of the churches, you hear the announcement or you see the notice. Please turn off all cell phones. You think somebody will rob you in the church and have a phone to call the police? But I saw that behavior once in a church. I was preaching. A man of disrepute walked in the church, went and sat down next to some people. And next thing I saw two plainclothes officers walking in and escorted the man out of the church. Just as I was given the final blessing, he walked straight back in, came to the sanctuary, embraced me and said, "Father, I need help. I'm an alcoholic." People know where to find love. People know where to come for help. The church is a hospital for sinners. Why do we feel that we are so self-righteous that we are turning people out of the church? John was ready to stop them. The people in the camp was ready to stop Eldai and Medad, who have received the Spirit. We are running people from our churches. We are hurting members of our families because we are preaching one thing and living something else. We in church, Monday to Sunday, Sunday to Monday, we pray, we do in activity, but we ain't talking to our children. We're not forgiving our children. We're not loving our neighbors. My dearly beloved, wake up. Wake up. Live the attributes of God. Live the blessedness of the poor in spirit. For theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Let us, my brothers and sisters, change our doubts and start living as Christ Jesus invites us to live. Amen. Thank you, Father. At this time, I invite the choir to sing the Spirit song that the Son of God has called, and I invite you, prayerfully, quietly, formally, to bring up your gin of rams and you place them in the white bucket, which at the end of the Mass, we will have a cool pot, we will burn them.
You declare it.
There is power in the name.
Jump.